So, this talk is called Einstein's Relativity-Miller Project. So, according to this article on the internet, there has been 95 years of criticism of special relativity, and that's only taken it up to the year 2003. Since then, the criticism has been ongoing, and there's also been criticism of general relativity. So, Miller is a pseudonym adopted by a German research group for a massive compiling of materials opposed to Einstein's special theory of relativity and of international scope, i.e., they included documentations internationally. And it's presented 3,789 publications criticizing the theory, and it wants to distribute this documentation to libraries and so forth. So it's pointing out it's got 1,300 critics from the whole period of 1908 to 2003. And the person giving it is a pseudonym. The first open letter about the freedom of science to some 290 public figures, personalities, newspapers, and journals in Europe and the USA. And this is what they sent out. And it says, "Ladies and gentlemen, with the enclosed CD-ROM, we wish to inform you about the following facts, which are unknown to the general public and therefore will constitute real news for the media." It goes on, "There is no freedom of research and teaching in theoretical physics. Against all appearances, against all established laws, and against public conviction to the contrary. Since 1908 and until this day, there exists an uninterrupted tradition of criticism of the special theory of relativity. This criticism has been successfully suppressed and excluded from scientific discourse since about 1922, more or less in all countries." And by meaning more or less, sometimes it manages to escape from being suppressed and then it disappears again. "The suppressed criticism of some 80 years has never been discussed in science and therefore has never been refuted. As a logical consequence, the special theory of relativity remains an unconfirmed hypothesis and has never reached the proclaimed status of the best confirmed theory of physics. The many suggested experimental confirmations are refuted by the critics as wishful thinking, if not accused to be a deception of the public. We have started a research project of international scope," and that's where they list all the criticisms. Article then goes on to say, "Why do we need strict anonymity? The reason is to be found in the undemocratic and unlawful and uncivilized behavior of academic physics against any criticism of their holy theory, special relativity. Therefrom do arise five strong motivations to remain anonymous. One, to preserve the autonomy of the project, prevent any influence and hindrance from outside the project. Two, no lawful citizen has to expose himself to the slander and so forth, usually thrown upon the critics by the editors as their only means to answer the criticism." So if you criticize Einstein's relativity, you get in, or try to criticize it in the academia, you get heavily slandered. They don't address what you're saying to them, they only just slag you off as being an idiot. Now, what I say, Personally, I think it's because the because of the project being anonymous with its writers, that's one of the reasons why it gets ignored. In my experience, people have to put their name to what they whistleblow about and then accept the punishment for blowing the whistle. As per Wikipedia, a whistleblower is a person, usually an employee, who exposes information or activity within a private, public or government organisation that is deemed illegal, immoral, illicit, unsafe, fraud or abuse of taxpayers' funds. In the case of physics academia, if you got a professional qualification in physics, you're a physicist, you've got your PhDs and so forth, and you're going to come out and criticise Einstein's relativity, then you're going to get slandered. But if you then say, well, I'm going to keep my name anonymous, well, people don't know who you are, they don't know how professional you are in your field, and so they're just going to ignore what's going to be said. Being anonymous whistleblower doesn't work. You've got to say who you are, and you've got to have a really high reputation to then be taken seriously. So that's what's the problem with this article. So become a whistleblower and you make yourself a target from people who don't want their activity blown the whistle about. Obviously, as whistleblower, you think you're trying to do a good deed, but as per fairly well-known saying, no good deed goes unpunished. So if you're a whistleblower, you think you're doing a good deed, well, you're going to get punished for that. And that's the way society works. And as illustrated in this cartoon, this lady is thinking about blowing a whistle, and the people she's going to upset are putting a target bullseye on her back so they know who to punish. And so we have another picture of a person who's thinking about blowing a whistle, and he looks behind him and he sees all the daggers ready to stab in the back. A lot of the time people think about blowing the whistle, look around and see all the daggers waiting to stab in the back, and then they think better of blowing the whistle. As far as I know, the Mueller project didn't get anywhere and was just ignored. As I said, I think it was mainly ignored because it was anonymous. But however, there are some faces we can put to these things. This is one of the people. It's Jocelyn Lopez, who's from France and lives in Germany. She published in the internet with this other person the compilation of anti-special relativity material by the research group who had the pseudonym Mueller. And you can read what she's saying here. So she's been an activist and so forth. And another face you can put to the project is this face here. You can access the article from this person's website, and you can access it from other people's websites as well. So there are other faces, but hiding behind these faces is supposed to be anonymous. The anonymous person who is writing the Mueller project. And we go to the Mueller project, and it catalogues the type of errors in special relativity. As a systematic overview of the criticism, we have collected the most important aspects in the catalogue of some 130 errors. The errors are arranged into 21 thematic groups. So there is a lot to criticize in Einstein's relativity. You can criticize the aspect about the ether, about how it deals with light, about how it deals with space, about how it deals with time, about how it deals with movement, about how it deals with electromagnetism, about how it deals with Minkowski world or space-time, how it deals with mathematics, how it deals with mass and energy, how it deals with velocity, how it deals with gravitation, and how it connects to general relativity. You can criticize that. You can criticize how it connects to thermodynamics. You can criticize its treatment of experiments. You can criticize its theory of knowledge. You can criticize the methodology of relativity. And you can criticize the structure of the theory. And then you can criticize social pressure and the enforcement being pushed on keeping it. And then you can criticize its effects on other disciplines. And then you have motives for propagation of the theory, i.e. why do people want to stick with the theory and suppress other alternatives to it? So there's a lot there to criticize. For the early criticisms of Einstein's relativity, the article says, in Germany, the critical authors since 1922 are strictly outlawed by academic physics, and therefore unite the critical arguments against both relativities, that's general and special, in a booklet entitled 100 Authors Against Einstein. And that meant 100 authors against Einstein's relativity. And it was published in 1931, and it was protesting against the terror of the Einsteinians, that is, the people who supported Einstein's relativity. And it was edited by these people, Israel, Ruckhaber, and Weinmann. And it has nothing to do with anti-Semitism, as has been asserted by some relativists, but not by Einstein himself. The summary of the criticism from authors of several countries has never been answered by the relativists and never been taken serious by the general public. Einstein is said to have commented that one author would have been enough if there was any real reasons for criticism. The relativistic pretension is there are no reasons for criticism, and consequently there is no need for answers, i.e. criticism gets dismissed as anti-Semitic. And next video goes into more details about the book 100 Authors Against Einstein's Relativity.
This collection is sometimes understood as the attack of 100 German scientists against the Jew Einstein. It is false on many points, a fake news in a way. Already all the authors were not scientists. In the past, there was not the distinction that is made today between scientists and literary people. Cultured men, such as Bergson, for example, could be competent in both fields. This is why we find in these authors a lot of philosophers who can also master mathematics or the concepts of physics. So they are indeed authors, but they are not 100. There are only 28 contributors, each having written a more or less long text. Excerpts from texts published against the relativity of 19 other authors are then added. And at the end, it is given as a reference a list of 92 people known to fight relativity, including the 19 aforementioned. In total, 120 names appear, but there are only 47 published texts. Another misconception. It is not a 100% Germanic booklet either. Of course, of the 28 contributors, 18 are Germans, 2 are Austrians and 1 Swiss. But the other 7 come from France, Czechoslovakia, Finland, Sweden, the Netherlands, Italy and the United States. That is to say that a quarter of the contributors are not German-speaking. Let us just remember that during the interwar period, German physics was predominant. For example, from 1911 to 1932, Germany collected 7 Nobel Prizes in physics, 1 every 3 years on average. Finally, even if the title indicates it, it is not a work against the person of Einstein, but against the theory of relativity. Today as yesterday, Einstein embodies the theory of relativity. Perhaps, like today, putting Einstein's name on the cover may have seemed more attractive to them. More sales-orientated one would say nowadays that put the term of relativity. But, with a few exceptions that question Albert Einstein's, especially in math, there is no personal attack. Antisemite. Let's be clear, this book has a reputation for being anti-Semitic, so hardly anyone has tried to read it since its publication in 1931. This was also my idea of this book, as it was published in German and there is not even a French translation available. I went through it from an English translation done using Google, and what a surprise. Admittedly, the arguments developed are quite often of a philosophical nature. We will come back to them. But there is nothing anti-Semitic about it. This work was published in 1931. Let us look again in the context of the time. We obviously do not know that 10 years later, there will be the Second World War and the concentration camps. We do not know that 2 years later Hitler will come to power. In 1931 he was in the opposition. His party won less than 20% of the vote in the Bundestag. He was in the minority. Of course, Germany is in an economic crisis and anti-Semitism is progressing, but the Nazis are not in power. In 1931, Germany was living in a republican and democratic regime. It was the Weimar Republic. In 1931, the IOC, a multicultural international body, appointed the Berlin of 1931 to organize the future Olympic Games. So yes, later, out of the number, like many of their compatriots, some of the German authors will join or sympathize with the Nazi party. Walter Del Negro, Lothar von Mises, Walter Rauschenberg. But among these authors, there are also several people of Jewish ancestry or religion. Salome Friedlander, who will take refuge in Paris. David Goldsmith, who will take refuge in England. Oscar Krauss, who will be deported to Auschwitz. Emmanuel Lasker, who will take refuge in USSR then in the USA. And for George Wendel, philosopher and journalist evangelist, although non-Jewish, he will be missing during the Nazi period, and even today no one knows when and under what circumstances he died. And among the three organizers of the book was Hans Israel Antisemitic, and Dr. Rudolf Weidmann. Was he a Nazi? A former communist youth activist, he will be arrested and tortured by the Nazis, and he will then go to take refuge in Argentina. How could one accuse these authors of having fomented a book against Jewish physics? It is completely insane. Einstein did not respond to the substantive criticisms. We attribute to him this good word. One author would have been enough. Joke which has taken up to our days to evacuate any discussion on this book. And those who qualify this collection as anti-Semitic are those who have not read it, and those who feel attacked in their belief, in the theory of relativity.
So there is more at that website for the 100 authors against Einstein. And that was the criticism of Einstein's relativity up until World War II. After World War II, criticism of Einstein's relativity gets restarted in large part by Herbert Dingell. And the article, the Müller Project, says Herbert Dingell, who was a renowned relativist and author of a textbook on special relativity in 1940, started the subject relativity and space-time in 1956, criticizing the relativist idea that one twin may remain younger than the other. Dingell judged this idea to be in contrast with the relativity principle, on probably meaning contradiction with it. One cannot declare all moving inertial systems to be each relative to all the others and all having the same status, and at the same moment declare one twin to be younger than his twin brother. This is the point of Dingell's question: how can the theory decide which system has remained younger if all systems have the same relative status? I prefer to call it the clocks are different, but people have taken it to mean that aging is different for the twins. So one twin ages at a different rate to the other twin, but I would like to just think of it in terms of the clocks for the twins are different. And Wikipedia points out who Herbert Dingell was. He was an English physicist and philosopher of science who served as president of the Royal Astronomical Society from 1951 to 1953. So he's quite an impressive person, prestige in science, but even his criticism gets nowhere. It just gets ignored. What really they did was they just slandered Herbert Dingell. Article then goes on, probably all persons who one day discover that theoretical physics has organized suppression of freedom of teaching and research and a betrayal of the public to preserve their holy theory of special relativity from being recognized as wrong and nonsensical are shocked and irritated about the world they live in. The facts of suppression and betrayal are not to be doubted, but nonetheless they may seem unbelievable. And that is where a person such as myself finds himself. It's unbelievable that something that is nonsense is being taught. According to our own experience, one feels paralyzed because of the perfect and powerful organization of the betrayal of the public inside the sciences as well as outside. One needs a certain time of questioning, doubting, reasoning and judging about what could be done and what would have to be done. Everyone has to find his personal answer, his or her personal answer. Most persons who have reached this state of knowledge are alone and isolated and don't feel in a position to do something useful against what they have recognized as a great betrayal. Only few of them publish a book or an article expressing directly the reproach of betrayal or using Hans Christian Andersen's famous fairy tale of the Emperor's New Clothes as a metaphor. So Einstein's relativity is like the Emperor's New Clothes. It's nonsense. You have to see that it's not really there. And well, part of the way of preserving it, as I pointed out in my other videos, is you move the goalposts. So very few persons have tried to organize conferences or societies for discussion and promotion of criticism of the relativity theories, as we've documented. Until today, these activities did not reach the general public. So now things are on the internet, things are coming, more of it's coming out about this. But in the academic journals, they've managed to keep quiet about it. The Muller Project continues. This situation has created the idea to test the society of our country about how people react, if they will react at all, to the disclosure of the fact that in an important branch of academic physics, the democratic rights of freedom of expression, freedom of scientific research and teaching, and the freedom of discussion are suppressed. Would the people trust a doctor who acquired his medical knowledge in a university or medical school where no free discussions about health problems and the best solutions of therapies have been allowed? Would the people drive their cars and heavy trucks on highway bridges if the engineers had learned their profession of calculating the static without critical reasoning and free discussion of problems and so forth? I've corrected a few typo errors, which I think are there. And that is basically the finish, the end of this video. I pointed out that many people have worked out that Einstein's relativity doesn't really make sense, and they find that trying to talk about that in the academia gets suppressed. And I pointed out in my other videos, if you go through what academia is doing, they are moving the goalposts on what a lot of things they're saying about relativity. They're not staying to a fixed theory of saying this is relativity. They're actually changing what they're saying. Thank you. The end of this talk.